Good evening,
Thank you.
everybody.
Thank you for being here. I was planning to ask you, how are you? But that would be too mainstream, right? To a person like you, the more appropriate question would be, hello, and what are you watching these days?
Well, actually, more than watching, I've been filming consistently, continuously through the pandemic. Put a short film out for about, which is about 13 minutes in length. Did a independent video, music video, which is about 6 minutes in length. And then filmed something for Amazon called Putam Pudukale. Was part of an anthology, directed M.S. Bhaskar and Ritu. And then have directed another short for Netflix called Navarasa, which Mr. Maniratnam and Jayendra sir are producing. So I've been busy more than watching films.
Yes, sir. Glad to hear that you've been busy during the pandemic. So back to business, OTT. So everybody had an idea that OTT would be a major disruptor of the movie industry. You know, but we were not expecting it to happen for at least in the next 4 or 5 years. You know, I would say this pandemic has played a predominant role in propelling all of us into that future. So I personally remember very vividly watching the FDFS of N.A. Rendal in Jyothi Theatre in Chennai. We are brought up in a culture which taught us that movie watching experience is synonymous to a celebration. From such a place, I really think Indians are very quickly transitioning and adapting to the OTT platform, which has given us so much comfort, ease, and of course, variety, accessibility, and flexibility. This is all from a point of view of an audience. How is the industry taking this disruption? How are you taking it, and what are the good things that have come out of this for you as a filmmaker and a producer?
I don't look at it as disrupting of the film industry. I think at every point there is an alternative. At every point, that's what it tells us. So from film to digital, from television to big time television, and now from theaters to watching content on the OTT platforms in the comforts of your home or wherever you are. At every point there is an alternative, and it all depends on how well you can straddle sort of both the alternatives that you have in hand. And if you don't do it, I think you're a fool. So the idea of making a film or narrating a story or putting your thoughts out or putting an idea out, or even if it's with a message or without a message, and even if it's just entertainment, the idea is not just for you to watch it, right, on your phone or in your house once you've made it. It's for an audience to watch. And this is now reaching out to an audience across the world. I mean, and during the pandemic, it's very widely known that people across the country and across the world have watched content from everywhere across the world. Somebody sitting in Delhi knows who a Fahad Fazil is very easily today. Whereas I think it would have been a little difficult to establish that, so why not? I'm saying this seems to be like a great alternative platform for filmmakers to exhibit their wares. And like I said, I'd be a fool if I don't, make the best use of it. Yes, there are corporates sitting and governing these platforms and the content and everything. And that is a process that anyway you go through with a producer or an actor or a star, so you might as well put it out where so much more audience can watch your idea or watch your thought or watch your visuals or watch your films, so I'm very happy to be in a place where I think I can coexist. And now if I have to bring an audience to the theater, I know those films have to be event films. There has to be something much bigger, not maybe in terms of a spectacle by itself, there has to be something bigger for an audience to leave the comforts of their home and their work and come to the theater. And I'm ready to rise up to the challenge to give you interesting content. So my mind is working overtime. And when I say my mind, I mean the film industry, the work, the technicians, the creators, they're all working overtime now to see if we can put content across into the theaters and onto the OTT platforms.
That's totally true, sir. You answered my next questions also, but still, I would like to ask something about the corporate structure you were talking about. So as we all know that you are a person with a knack of improvising on spot and doing things that was not in the script, but you go there, you get a feel and you change the script and so on. So if that is the case, and OTT is a platform which has a typical organizational structure, and every decision, every significant change has to go through multiple stakeholders, and that will of course take time. So how do you see that? Do you think that there is more creative freedom for you? Because, as you said, there are a lot of teams, say legal team is there, there is a finance team, there are a lot of other teams also, they restrict the number of episodes you do. Sometimes we've heard that they're involved in casting and other things also. So, do you think there is more creative freedom when it comes to OTT than in normal mainstream theater release movies?
I think that creative freedom is depending on how solid a personality you are, or how sure you are of your work, and how great your communication skills are, which takes us back to school and college and what we learned at home, which is so important. I think you are the master of your own creative freedom, depending on the kind of person that you are, and I've always believed in that. Now, you want to sit and listen to other people telling you what to do, then you'll have to step back always. But if you're the kind that will push your way across, then you are the master of your own creative freedom. Like, I remember, before I became a filmmaker, in the sense before I made my first film, and after I worked with Rajiv sir for about 2 years on a feature film, there was an opportunity where I was working as an assistant to a particular, he was a first-time filmmaker himself, but he was setting up a music video, and he was not able to tell the actress the shots and what to do in the frame and all that. And for about 2 hours, there was no work happening. With all due respect to him, he was just sitting and figuring out and all that. So I just looked at him and said, "Can I step in?" If I hadn't taken that call that day, I don't think I would have been the filmmaker that I am today. I realized I myself, I'm an introvert. I speak very less and all that. But when it comes to work, I know that I have to push myself, lose my inhibitions and act and dance and sing, and in front of 100 people, I have to show an actor or a cameraman or a technician what I want, to get my visual imagery across. Otherwise, it's not going to be your film at all. Likewise, so with feature films, there is a producer, there are financiers, there is a star actor who will want certain things to suit his image. So you have to go through all that and still find your creative space within that. Likewise, with the OTT, there are, very intelligent people sitting on the platforms, figuring out if this content will work. So that process is there, and that's a process that I enjoy because there is back and forth, there is discussion, and it all leads up to something being made right within the right time space. There is funding that comes in once they like an idea for development, which doesn't really happen with feature films. So there are a couple of minds working together with a whole team to see if this product can be taken and finished with the beauty that it needs. And then there is very corporate governance in process. The production is taken care of, minutely, details are taken care of, so it's a whole beautiful process, and that's the way film should be made. And what these half an hour shorts and this pandemic filming has also done is it's brought down the number of days drastically. So you can shoot a 40-minute film in like 6 days, which means to make a 2 hour film you just need 18 to 20 days, and earlier we shot for 70 to 80 days because of various reasons, but now we've found that that we can actually film much faster and actually properly also. So I really feel we are, this is just the tip of the iceberg. I feel we're on the step of a beautiful way forward. I feel we're on the verge there. We're on the threshold, I feel, and we're just waiting to sort of explode into that.
Nice, perfect. And the next question would be on the producer's side. So, as we see, this OTT is becoming more and more affordable, and with mainstream movies are releasing directly on these platforms, we really see that the producers are now likely to get a quicker return on their investments and even face lesser risks. So, I think the supply side is becoming more risk-averse, while the demand side, the consumers, they are also becoming more cost-conscious. So, as a community of filmmakers in collaboration with theater owners and distributors, as you were mentioning, what are the plans? What is next? What in Indian context, in an Indian movie industry, what do you think will be the next big thing?
See, I really think once everybody is a little assured that we are in sort of safe zone, with the pandemic situation and there's no second wave and things have eased out a little bit and the vaccine comes in and all that. There's so much of discussion which we're all part of every day. Once people come out, to the theaters as such, we will coexist for some time for sure. But your opening line is what, really matters. There is a safe return of investment if your product is right with the right actors. Then there is a safe return of investment straight away with the OTT platforms because they want content. There are people sitting at home waiting to watch content or anywhere, over the weekend. At the end of the day, you switch on something and you want to watch for 45 minutes to 1 hour, and then you pick it up the next morning. Or if it's really interesting, you watch it for 2.5 hours at one stretch. So I think this is the way forward. I think we coexist. Filmmakers straddle sort of, both streams. Theaters, and like I said, to put a film out in the theater, it has to be event films. A normal film is not going to interest me to come and watch in the theater. I myself, I'm an avid theater goer, I'm desperate to get to the theaters and watch something. I'm desperate to watch a nice big film, but somewhere it has to draw me into the theaters. What's released now is not drawing me into the theaters as yet. I'm still worried, you know. But if there is a film that'll interest me and it'll help me, it'll assure me that forget the COVID situation and all that, I need to go and watch this film. That sort of film is yet to come, you know, and I'm sure those films are being made. But at the same time, producers are safe if they package their film right, and if the big actors come in, then the return of their investment is very safe here. And we've seen that with a couple of big films that have released recently. You know, I think even to quote an example, I think Surare Potru is actually seemingly looking like the best release of the year, and lots of people have watched it, and the reviews are good and all that, if they matter. But that is the way forward to a large extent, I feel, you know. Yeah.
Yes, a lot of people are just waiting to get out there and go to theaters, just like you. So the next question from my side would be a very important question to me. I've been asking this to a lot of artists that I meet, writers, filmmakers, and all. The question is, should a film be socially responsible? So I've always wondered about the political correctness in art. Though this leads to the existential question of what is right and what is wrong, how do you ensure it? Given a choice, would you accept a movie that would cater the taste buds of general audience, or a movie that would question the morality of or politics of a certain setting?
I think it's the way we live our life. I believe in that. Your daily life that you lead, with your family and your friends, there are lines that you don't cross, right? You don't say a few things, even though it might be in your head, because it's not nice. It's not right. It's not politically correct. You might feel something about somebody, but you might not say it. Or you will go and say it. If there's something atrocious that's happening, you might say a word or put your feelings out. And so that's the way I think filmmakers also work, especially when I write my script. I tend to stay on the line. I don't really cross the line. I am politically correct. I want to make sure that there is a family that can watch the film. And now, if the content is about something that cannot be watched by a general audience, then I put it out in that way. If I need to narrate the story of, let's say, with an example of a film that I particularly did, if it's an example of a film like Nadu Nesinayagal, which is about a psychopath serial killer who needs help, who needs medical help, he's mentally ill. So then I put the word out that this is a film about that, and the images might be disturbing to the audience. I don't change the censor certificate around. I don't plead with the censors to give me a universal certificate. So I am responsible in that sense. I think that's the way I've led my life also. And there are some things of which I don't on social media or anywhere which I really don't want to talk about. But then there are some things that I might reach out directly to that person and not express my views through social media. And even in terms of charity and stuff like that, what I'm doing need not be mentioned or told to, a social platform. It should be, I believe in what the right hand does, the left hand should know, and the other way around also. So I work in that sense. So if you particularly ask me that question, it's the way I lead my life. I like to be correct about certain things, and that's the way I make my films also. Yeah.
Great, sir. Thank you. The next question is about the reviewers. Back in those days, there was no big reviewers, self-proclaimed critics, as we see now. Given the accessibility, people are now not only able to get their hands on international content, there's also been a huge uprising in YouTube reviewers community. There's also a lot of fan clubs, hate clubs, Twitter attacks, and so on. Do these critics or self-proclaimed critics or reviewers have any impact on the numbers you make? Numbers in sense, be it your number of the views or the box office numbers. And these are all their, personal views, and art is subjective. So having said that, are these people affecting the way you make your movies?
Yeah, so you said it. Actually, the answer is what I already had in my mind, which I've said many times. Art is subjective. My art cannot be reviewed by you because your art is different, right? And a filmmaker that I know recently mentioned something which I really liked. I'm making a film about cricket. My film is a cricket game, actually, this particular film, metaphorically speaking. If you tell me the way I've played this game is wrong, and to correct that in my next film, my next game is a football game, actually. I'm not playing cricket in my next film. And in my third film, I'm playing golf. So how can you tell me that, to correct my football moves here? I can't do that. So my art cannot be reviewed. I don't read reviews. Yes, I have respect for reviewers, and that's their job. And I know that it impacts a section of the society, a section of the film-going audience that largely depends on reading reviews and comes to the theaters. But I do believe that a big star can draw any audience into the theater in spite of, oh, okay, reviews seriya liya. In spite of that, let's go see the film. There is a section of audience that works like that also. a big filmmaker, Mr. Maniratnam, actually, when I spoke to him once about a particular review affecting, the way my mind was working, he said, "You've made your film the way you want to make it. You've not called the team and discussed the film, right?" I said, "No. You've not shown your film to a few to 10 people before release, like a focus screening, and then made changes. No. You've completely gone with your gut and instinct. Yes. Then why do you bother about what the reviewer says? You put your film out there. We are in the line of work. We are in the line of work where our work is meant to be critiqued. Our work is meant to be reviewed. So then that's their job. But you forget it and you move on." So for about 7 years now, I don't read reviews. I know all the popular reviewers who exist and their work, and I know them personally also, but I don't read the good or bad reviews. What I go with is when a film releases, you automatically get that vibe, no matter where you are. You get the vibe that it's doing well or it's not going down well with the audience. You put out an idea, sometimes it reaches the audience in a great way, sometimes it doesn't. So that's all it is. So that's my view on reviews and whether it affects a film or not.
To add on to this, don't you think these reviewers
Some
are like
lights.
a feedback?
Yeah, go on. I'm just gonna turn on some lights here.
Yeah, these reviewers are like a a feedback from the customers and how the end consumer, the viewers' views of the world are changing and stuff. You don't feel that way? Like, is it this is like audience talking back to you through a set of people?
So the set of people doesn't matter as long as they come to the theaters, pay money for their tickets and watch the film and the review. It really doesn't matter because that adds to the coffers, right? We want the audience to come to the theater. Yes, the film is out for a general audience. If you tell me yes, a reviewer is also an audience, then he should just watch the film and go back and not put his views out. I honestly feel that. But I know it doesn't affect the film per se beyond a certain point. And I'd call it a very small percentage of people not watching a film because, the reviews are bad. I honestly think it really doesn't matter.
Great. So we have some questions from the audience also. So one of the I'm building on one of the questions that I see. So GVM is a brand, whether you like it or not. So a brand is nothing but a promise to a promise of a certain quality to the customer. So there are expectations when it's come when it comes to your movies, like a smart, brave hero or stereotype breaking women characters, etc. So when this is absent, people tend to appreciate the movie less, and we have seen it, right? Even in big directors' names, like say if Mr. Anurag Kashyap makes a movie like Ek Deewana Tha, there will be difficulty of people accepting those kind of movies. So how are your OTT end consumers, the viewers, different from a theater-going audience? Do you feel there is something very special about them and you have to cater that, or are they interchangeable?
Yeah, I honestly feel that. I feel everybody in a family gets to sit and watch within the comforts of their home or wherever they are, not in the theater. And the content that the platforms are encouraging these days is very different from a star-driven content that I might write for a superstar actor or one of the big star actors, So largely, an actor sees what moments a director has created for him in that film. He doesn't, I honestly think he doesn't look at the overall content by very few actors look at the overall content. He's looking at moments created for his star power to be driven, in a better way, for his image to be put out in a better way. So which is why most of the big stars have not come to the OTT platforms as yet, because they want that rush from the audience in the theater. They want the audience to walk out calling out their names, and they want to hear that, when the opening screen scene happened, the whistles flew and all that stuff. They don't know if that's going to happen in every home, right, when people are watching on the OTT, which is why they've not come to the OTT as yet. And they will, I'm sure they will at some point, because that's going to be the way forward, to a large extent. So most of the content that is made for feature films with the bigger directors and even the newcomer directors are all, especially in Tamil, are all star driven and written for the stars. You can get to make smaller films, but then the producers themselves are not going to come with enough money for you to make that film. But with OTT and with the platforms that exist right now, they're looking at very interesting content and not necessarily star-driven content. They only want content that they think will be different from what is normally out there. And they look at it and analyze it and rather go that way, because you get to make the film the way you want. Even the way you make those films per se is very different from when you make a film for the theaters, because there you're thinking 2 hours, in and out, your shots are cut accordingly, your shots are staged accordingly. But for OTT, you don't have to stage your shots like that. The whole filmmaking process is very different, I feel. Yes, I still am saying, and I'm not just saying it to be politically correct, I'm completely driven by being in a theater and feeling that rush and that magic and everything. But right now, I am looking to put out interesting content, and I know that content may not be appreciated by the actors and the producers to make a theatrical sort of a film. So I'm happy to coexist. And right now my focus is to put out a lot more films where a larger audience can watch me. So somebody was saying the other day, promotions of a film on platform should reach the interiors of Tamil Nadu a lot more. But I was trying to tell them that you're making a Tamil film, but it's going to be watched all over the world, across maybe, you know, 100 countries, you know, in across 30 subtitles and languages. You know, so why are you so worried about, you know, a Tamil audience will anyway watch it for your name, but you're reaching out to a larger audience. So let's think of it like that. You know, so we have to look at it like that. The idea of a film is for more audience to see your work, right? We are there. This is the space that people haven't realized it as yet, I feel.
Yeah, that is...
And in terms of the brand, yeah. So I've not called myself a brand. I know the question wasn't directed particularly at me. I'm saying I've not come out saying this is the kind of films that I'm going to make. So, you know, I'm going to be a brand. And so when you watch every film of mine, come with these expectations. I'd rather the audience not come with any expectations and sort of take in from whatever I'm able to give. And sometimes I know that magic will not work in a theater. In a theater, there is a certain magic that has to work right from the first frame. The audience has to be like-minded. They have to get the feel that comes from the screen. Now, this is, you know, more than science. There's a kind of supernatural element to this. And trust me, this works. A collective audience of about 400 to 500 people and above have to be like-minded about what the frames are that's thrown at them. They have to be in the same vibe. And that's the filmmaker's sort of idea. You know, that's the idea that we put out for the audience to grab. And I know sometimes that will not work right from the first 5 minutes of the film. I've known for a couple of films of mine that that's not working as I planned it out to be. And, you know, and that you can never guess. And I make films from my heart. It's all about gut and instinct and all that. So one never knows. It's an attempt to try and put the film out to an audience and maybe they'll like it or not, but you never know. And I'm ready to experiment more and more again and again. Yeah.
Okay. So the other question from the audience is, we have a news about a hashtag trending in Twitter. So what is your take on the recent increase in, say, boycott XYZ based on some content, not like by a section of people, and then those, you know, ads and films, sad films, the films taking been taken down and modified. So there has been a lot of public involvement in what content should be published, right? What is your take on that?
I don't understand. What are you talking about? Any specific?
Today there is a hashtag that is trending on Twitter saying boycott Netflix. And what? We have seen this as a trend over the past a lot of, you know, weeks now, and not weeks, even months. And there is a lot of content that is being taken down because it's not liked by a certain set of people, or it does not, you know, go in with their ideologies. So what do you think about this public involvement in art? So how do you see that? Is it, I know it is not a very good path to trot, but how do you want to educate your audience that this is not the right way?
So it works both ways, right? Like when you see a reviewer is one person or maybe a team of three or four who have written a review, and millions of people, according to your question earlier, are going to read that review, and are they going to decide reading that review whether they're going to come to a film or not? It's just one person's opinion. Likewise, that film is one person's opinion. I don't know what you're talking about right now, but that film is particularly one person's opinion about something, and it's cleared a few other people and it's been put out. That doesn't necessarily mean the platform is endorsing it, or it doesn't necessarily mean that is the collective endorsement. Now, I think being human beings today and being citizens of a country today, you have the right to sort of take what you want and leave what you want without being, you know, particularly agitated or angsty about it. You know what I'm saying? You don't necessarily have to be. And that mindset will actually pave the way for a lot of peace across, you know, countries. And I operate like that. And I know a lot of people who work like that. So that is my idea. I might watch something disturbing. It's my opinion or right to sort of put that off and move on. That doesn't mean I want to break my TV set or, you know, I want to destroy the platform or anything like that. I don't think like that at all. Yeah.
Okay. And one more question, and building on that question. So we have seen a lot of changes in movie industries from 1980s. Say there was this deck, and there was the VCDs, then there were pirated VCDs, then DVDs, then torrents coming in, and now it's OTT. So how far do you think the shift of movie industry to OTT platform permanent? Or can we see a complete rehaul of the revenue model? Or as you said, how far will this coexisting be profitable to theater owners? Because theater owners are investing a lot of money, you know, but when you have a paradigm shift of audience more preferring the OTTs, do the theater owners have their return on their investments?
So theater owners also, with all due respect to them, and being an avid theater goer myself, but not saying this again to be politically correct, will they release any film that a filmmaker wants to put out? I'm saying it, they're still looking for the big ticket films, right? The films where huge crowds will come in, where you know, the stalls will be filled, the balconies will be filled, and their food and catering section also will be taken care of, and there'll be lots of parking. So it's a collective thing. Now, they know with the smaller films is not going to happen, right? So doesn't a smaller filmmaker have the right to put his film out wherever he wants to? So if you're telling me that a theater will put out any kind of film, you know, then I'm saying yes, they are affected by this, but that's not the case. Filmmakers and films are affected because not every film gets to the theaters. You know, there is a distribution channel, there is a producer, there are theater owners who will also say, no, I don't want this particular film, you know. So when there is an alternative platform, why not? And yes, this is going to change the revenue model right now. This is going to look differently at the way you know, the film and film business was talked about for almost 20 years now. And I mentioned this some time ago, this changes across 20 years that's happened, from your LDs to your DVDs, before the VHSs, and then, you know, from film to digital itself. A lot of us didn't want to accept the changeover from a film camera shoot to a digital shoot, you know. And then when we realized that there's so many more advantages to digital filmmaking, we all plunged in, you know, into it, you know, very wholeheartedly. And today that's the name of the game, actually. You know, a big cinematographer was telling me that in 2 years' time, people will only start shooting, you know, everything on YouTube, and everything will be shot only on the iPhone. You know, you don't need any other cameras for that. So change is always there. You know, change is the only constant, actually. How we adapt to it and how well do we adapt to it? Yes, sometimes we don't necessarily wholeheartedly adapt to it, but I sincerely feel now is the time. Like I said earlier, we are on the threshold of something really huge, and only the intelligent minds will want to coexist, I feel, and they should.
Rightly said, sir. And the next question is on the large number of anthologies that you have been seeing in OTT platforms. So why does the collaboration of writers and directors seem to work better in OTT than it does in a mainstream movie? Are there any particular obstacles for that, or is it just because the platform is new and the filmmakers or producers are just not too sure about what the people expect and just trying out different genres in the same movie? So what is your take on that?
No, this was always there. It's just that it's coming out to the fore only now, because there are platforms that are encouraging it. Always there are writers, but most filmmakers want to write the story themselves and write the dialogues themselves. I myself have tried to collaborate with writers from my first film, but somewhere sensibilities haven't matched, if they are good sensibilities or not, you know. And I kind of write it myself and take it forward. And I know other filmmakers also have worked like that. But somewhere at some point, I found material that I've liked that's come from somebody else, and then I put myself into it. Only as a director, I'm taking it forward. For example, Nidhane in Poon Vasundham. And then, you know, Queen itself, you know, which we put out on MX Player, was written by Reshma Gatala. And I gave it a filmmaker's, you know, sort of feel and look and all that stuff. And I directed it. Likewise, the anthology that we did for Amazon, Puttum Pudukale, was also, I only directed it in the sense, it's not only directed. Yes, I put everything into it, but the material came to me on a platter, you know. So collaborative efforts are only coming out now. They've always been there. And honestly speaking, with Tamil films especially, it's a huge collaborative effort. The names just don't go out. That's all it is. Most filmmakers have a big team that they sit with. They discuss with a lot of Western directors, will narrate scenes, writers will tell them scenes and stuff like that. But finally, it's only one person's name that goes out. Only now, I think, with today's filmmakers, everybody likes to put other people's names out also. You know, that's all it is.
Great, sir. And the other question is on, you know, learning. So every industry has to keep learning and equipping yourself with a lot of new things and, you know, things that are coming in. So as a filmmaker, apart from, you know, thinking about stories, do you think being tech savvy helps you being more creative, like knowing about how the camera works, knowing about the editing or the sound? So does it make any difference in the quality of the movie, or creativity is independent of technical knowledge? What is your take on that?
No, I see. You can be creative from birth. You can be a writer. You can write poetry. You can be good at debate. So you have a voice, you know, and you're writing a lot and you're creative. Yeah, on the whole. But we're talking about filmmaking. Now, filmmaking, when it comes to filmmaking, you need to be technically sound too. You need to be technically adept, you know, that you have to be. If you're just writing a book, then you don't need to know about light and sound and images and stuff. Like, all the creative thought process goes into writing a book, or it's just on a paper and you put yourself out. But we're talking about films, and film is a visual medium. It's right, it's visual imagery. It's images put together. Now, it helps because when you come to the sets and you're telling your cinematographer that you want the first shot to come from here and you want to see the hero's face, and you're very sure that this is where the shot has to be staged, but you know there is light, you don't know there's light at the back, you know, and his face might not be seen clearly, he'll be only in silhouette. And you can't be arguing with cinematographer saying, I want the shot, you know, like this. So if you were technically sound, you'd rather not suggest something like that. What you do is you wait for the time when the light moves from this side to that side. So it's good to know the science and the art behind, you know, filmmaking, to sort of be on top of your game. It definitely helps. And since we're talking about filmmaking, I insist that somebody has to either learn, there are lots of books available, or go through the colleges and all that, otherwise, which are there for filmmaking. Otherwise, you learn from a filmmaker that you work with for over one or two films. You learn production, you learn the art of filmmaking itself. Nobody's going to take classes for you, but it's all about watching and being in it and observing and experiencing it by being in it. So I think it sort of has to work together. You are creative, and at the same time, you have to be technically sound also.
Great. Okay. The next question is about the platforms. So you have worked for MX Original, Prime India, Netflix. Do you see any firm level differences between the working of these? Like, generally, in a general perspective, Netflix is considered to be a more international thing, and Amazon Prime has a lot of regional content compared to Netflix. So if you plan to make a web series, so does this platform impact your decision of what kind of story you want to build?
So straight away, I will say yes, all the platforms that you mentioned work very differently. There's no uniform method of working. And like I said, you have to be smart enough to approach a certain platform in a certain way. And you also have to be smart enough to know where the reach is, because your idea, like we discussed earlier, is to make your film to be watched by a lot of people, right? Across, which is the idea of a film. It's not just to be watched by one or two people in your own homes, you know? So you approach a platform knowing which has got the larger reach and, you know, where people would like to watch content, and you sort of pitch to them. I know people who will pitch to a platform, and when it doesn't work, they move to the other one. So I've never worked like that so far. And hopefully I won't have to, and I don't think I will either, like move from one. So I've always taken a particular content to a particular platform, and then we've sort of taken it forward right now. And they all work differently, and you have to know how to work with them.
The next question is about your house, Ondraga Entertainment. So this Ondraga Entertainment was there on YouTube before the advent of Netflix and Amazon Prime to this level. So, and you were producing a lot of independent songs, web series, you're doing a lot of things on Ondraga Entertainment. And with this Netflix and Prime, what would be the future of Ondraga Entertainment? Because I really think the margins, the reach is higher in Netflix and Amazon, if I'm not wrong. So what would be the future of Ondraga Entertainment from...
No, there's no comparison, actually. You know, it's like there's no comparison between Ondraga and Netflix. So otherwise, I'd put all my films on Ondraga, you know. So there is a very healthy set of people or in numbers that watch the content that we put out on Ondraga. And that's more a passionate sort of a thing. You know, we didn't look at it as a money-making venture. It was to encourage small filmmakers to come and put out, you know, their shorts. And we're doing that consistently since then. It was also for a, you know, filmmaker like me to put out, you know, material that's not film per se. You know, it's not just film music that music is all about. The music is about a lot more other things, is what I felt. So, and when you go to a music label, they ask you which film is a song associated with, who are the actors, and that's when they'll put the money out and all that. So I decided at some point that I'm not looking at this for money. I want to put this content out, and it's not associated with any film, and let the audience, you know, just watch it and sort of like it or not, you know. And since then, we've got a healthy set of subscribers who've come in and they watch this content that's we put out on YouTube, and we're very happy. So we are not in any way, you know, I'm happy you asked me this question in that vein and tone, but we are not in any league compared to them, you know. So they, I'm writing stuff and I'm picking up material that's written by other writers to make films on Netflix and Amazon and every other platform that's there. But Undraga is there as a production house that will make films, that will produce films that will be put out in theaters, that will also produce films to be put out on Netflix and Amazon and Hotstar and other platforms. And all the small filmmakers and filmmakers like me will put out our small films and independent videos and stuff, and we will exist forever.
Great. So the last question that I would like to ask is about the OTT platforms coming under the purview of the Central Censor Board. So do you think it will affect the quality of the unbiased content that will draw the audience to OTT, or will creators find a way to circumvent this?
See, we've always found a way. Also, I don't believe in that kind of filmmaking. I know it's called over-the-top content, and that name is sort of stuck. It doesn't make any sense right now, because I've not made content which I think should be over-the-top, you know? I'm not putting out content on Amazon, Netflix, thinking this is, you know, what's the word to use? This is adult content, or this is, this can pass the censor purview, and hence let me put it out. I know. I'm not looking at it as a platform like that at all. I'm only looking at putting out interesting content that might not be within the purview of what an actor wants, a star wants, or a certain producer who's looking to make the big money, want. It's not that. I'm only looking to make interesting content, like a story between a grandfather and a granddaughter, you know, who visits him and spends half an hour with him. Might not be material that an A-list superstar actor or, one of the star actors might want, you know. So I got to make it with somebody like an MS Bhaskar and a Ritu. And I had, Amazon's greenlighting it because, you know, they like this content. So I'm only looking at putting out content like that. It's not necessarily over the top in that sense. And it's not disturbing content. And I don't believe in watching content like that also in the confines of my home. You know, I'm not searching content on these platforms to figure out what is adult and, you know, can I watch that? No, I just want to watch material that will stimulate my mind, even if it's children and even if it's folk and even if it's, below 13 and stuff like that. So I don't come under that category of filmmakers or the audience itself. So it really doesn't matter to me if it comes under the purview of the Information and Broadcasting Ministry. But like you said, filmmakers will circumvent. They'll know how to put their wares out. And like we've done all along, even with the censor board existing, our feature films have had content that I think should be watched by a lot of people.
Thank you, sir. That was really insightful, and we are running out of time. Wish I could have more time with you to discuss a lot of things, but there is a limit. And thank you so much for being here. It was very insightful and interesting talking to you.